Well, my name is Father Gino De La Rama. I'm the Vocations Director for the Archdiocese of Newark. I am very excited to be with everybody today. It's been great getting to know Rhonda and the whole crew at Vocation Ministry these past few years. I've been a priest for almost over seven years here in the Archdiocese of Newark, which is in the northeast corner of New Jersey, right across the river from Manhattan. I grew up here my whole life and became a priest. It was, like Rhonda was saying, it was a little bit of a struggle trying to understand the difference between the diocesan parish priesthood and the religious priesthood. And I always try to make, admittedly, probably a poor analogy between, with using a military context, right? Religious priests with their charism have their specialization. They feel free being able to live out that charism every single day. That gives them a sense of being able to live out what God has always called them to do, whether that be serve the poor, serve the elderly, teach, et cetera, et cetera. While the diocesan parish priesthood is more of your frontline responder in the foxhole, responding to anything that's being asked of the priesthood within the church, within a particular territory. And so we're very soon going to be hearing from Father Joe Finnegara, the administrator here in St. Paul's in Greenville in Jersey City, in just a matter of moments. But to share just a little bit about how I became a priest, I was, like I said, grew up in Jersey City my whole life and went to school at Rutgers University in Newark with a political science major and an urban studies minor. Wanted to pursue public policy and study law because it was such an excellent opportunity to do that there and to just be involved with civil service and municipal work in general. But I received a, and that's what I majored in my undergraduate work, but I received a unique opportunity to go on the missions for 3 weeks down in Central and South America to really encounter the poor and experience that kind of, that dimension really of the missionary nature of the church and of the gospel. And I loved it so much that I took up, after doing that 3 week trip, decided to do it for a year. And then after doing that for an entire year, I asked to do it for another year, and it ended up being 5 years. And in 5 years in Central and South America, you know, running around with a backpack and traveling to every country in between Mexico and Peru, and experiencing so many different communities and so many different ways in which people encounter the faith, I didn't realize that God was setting me up to see behind the collar an experience of the priesthood. Every priest that I was with, whether he was religious or whether he was diocesan, whether he was young or old, I was so moved by their heroic example and their generosity to give of themselves entirely to the people that they were with. And it moved my heart so much. God was really using that experience that was so vivid and so inspiring to say, you know, to kind of poke at my heart and to say, you know, I think I would like you to really consider this, to give your entire life away to the church. And so I was moved by that, entered the seminary back home here in the Archdiocese of Newark at Seton Hall University, and then went to a parish in the northern part of our diocese called Our Lady of Mount Carmel in Ridgewood. Was blown away at parish life, was there for 3 years. I loved being with everybody through all their ups and downs. And then the Cardinal asked me to be the vocations director of the Archdiocese, which basically gives me an opportunity to walk with young guys who are wrestling with this whole thought of giving their lives away in service of the gospel and of the sacraments to people who really need it most. Today, I have such an awesome opportunity to interview a priest, Father Joseph Ferneguer, who I consider to be a good friend of mine. I was so excited and happy when he was assigned to be here at St. Paul's in Greenville, because this is actually the parish of my childhood. I was an altar boy here. I was in youth ministry here. I used to live, you know, just 6-7 blocks down the street. I went to school here at our parochial elementary school, stickball legend from in the parking lot. Nobody else calls me that aside from myself, but I drive past the parking lot and I consider that, you know, to be like our own little field of dreams. And so when he came here as a friend of mine, I was so excited because of all the nostalgia. And I knew that he would pour himself out for the people that are here. And so I'm giving Father Joseph this awesome opportunity to share his love for this awesome parish in an inner city setting. And I'm just happy that he's able to be here with his bike and to be able to share his love for parish ministry. And so, Father Joe, so happy to have you.
Thank you. It's good to be here. I was, it's always exciting when you get to talk about your ministry and share a little bit about what you do, because the priesthood, it's hard to market. You know, we had a new employee come to work here, and she started to see everything we do as church, the food pantry, the bereavement group, prayer groups. And she's like, I don't get it. You know, you always hear all this sort of stuff on the news about the Catholic Church. And she's like, me and my friends never really saw this part of it. And I said to her, I said, you know, that's because it's kind of hard to market. You have to live it. Somebody has to live it. They have to experience healing in their hearts. They have to experience hope in desperate situations, light in darkness. And when you live it and see it and experience it, it all starts to make sense. And that one person as an employee, it was fun watching her sort of engage with the life of the church. And as a priest, we have that opportunity every single day. And it surprises me every single day, because you wake up not knowing what's going to happen. You know, who's going to knock at your door, who you're going to run into when you're on your bike. Who's going to knock on my window? I'm sitting in my office. There's a window here for the drive. I've literally made appointments by people going, hey, Father Joe. And I'm like, yeah, I'm here. What's up? Hey, can we use the social center next Friday? Yeah, what time? You know, and it's just like, it's always moving. It's very dynamic. But just to, I'll give a brief introduction on myself and my vocation. But I grew up in New Jersey as well. New Jersey is an awesome place to live and to be. And I always have to say that, because when I studied in seminary, there were guys from all over the country, and they always had something negative to say about New Jersey. And I would actually get offended. So I started calling my really, you know, wiser buddies and being like, hey, what do you know about Kansas? What can I say about Kansas? Hey, what can I say about Michigan? You know, it's very easy to pick on New Jersey, but kind of like the priesthood, you just got to be here. You know, you got to live it and experience it. And it's a great place. I grew up here my whole life. I was an athlete. I did okay in school, you know, did fine. Like Father Gino, I went to Rutgers in Newark. Rutgers, Newark campus. I studied criminal justice and philosophy. I also wanted to get into law. I was accepted to law school. I sat in the orientation, says something really important and really profound that opened my mind. I was working in, it seems like you can. So I had been discerning priesthood and thinking about following a life of ministry and mission and proclaiming the gospel, so on and so forth. And I sat in this orientation at law school, and the dean of academics comes up and he says, listen, we could teach you everything you have to know about law in 1 year. He said, you're here for 3 years because you learn to be a lawyer. You learn to think like a lawyer, act like a lawyer, make, you know, talk like a lawyer. To me, I took that really personal. Now, there's nothing wrong with law. I mean, we work with some really great lawyers in the church with immigration and different things that they're involved in. But it was a wake-up moment for me. You know, I said to myself, I don't feel it in my heart that I want to be a lawyer. I would love to have the job of a lawyer and say, you know, that I practice law and, you know, feel good about myself and in my career. But I didn't want to be a lawyer. And that was a wake-up call that the priesthood is what I wanted to be. I wanted to be, if I was going to take on a vocation, if I was going to take on a life that I identify with, it was priesthood. And again, like kind of like what Father Gino shared, there were some really good examples and models in my life of men who knew what they were about, who were filled with faith, filled with virtue, filled with joy. And having that example, having that prayer, that moment of conversion, that moment of realization, I realized, you know what? I want to be a priest. And that was what kickstarted my whole process towards exploring what the priesthood was. So today I'm gonna speak a little bit about confession and some practical preparations and what happens during and afterwards. Confession is a unique topic to speak about because we're told don't speak about it. We're not, you know, obviously we have the seal of confession, so I will not reveal, of course, anything that I've heard in confession. But I'll talk a little bit about my personal experience. Before I go into that, I just want to share a little bit. I'm going to share my screen here because I want to share a little bit about what my ministry is and what it looks like, so that those of you who are following can see a little bit about what it's like to be in inner city ministry here in New Jersey, particularly in Jersey City. You're going to see a mix of things in this video, both the architecture of the church. It's a neo-Gothic structure, so it has those points leading us up. So anything that's Gothic or neo-Gothic, it's meant to draw our eyes upwards towards a heavenly reality. And so you can see that in this picture just from the outside. And when you walk in too, everything is arched. Everything is meant to lift you high. So in the late 19th century, when this particular church was built in 1886, they had that intention. And neo-Gothic architecture was a major movement in that time. Our cathedral in Newark is also under the neo-Gothic style. Again, meant to lift you up towards heavenly realities. So you're gonna see the different aspects of the architecture of the church, the love that the people of this area had for God and for the church, and the investment that they made, both of money and time, to build such a beautiful structure. You're gonna see some images of the stained glass window, the Stations of the Cross, which were hand-carved, imported from France. You're also gonna see some aspects of the life of ministry here with youth, with prayer groups. So I'm just gonna play it. It's about 2 minutes long, and I'll try to stop talking so that you guys can enjoy the video. All right, let's do this! So we're in the Greenville section of Jersey City. So it's also in Greenville.
For the city, for the world we pray. Let your light shine down, come around and live in us. For the close and the far away. Jesus Christ, lay down his life.
So I hope that gave a little bit of a preview of what ministry looks like here. One thing you'll notice in particular, it's super diverse, both in our Spanish and our English ministry. I mean, English Mass, it's Nigerian, Kenya, Philippines, Irish, Italian, German, like it's just as mixed as it gets. And then even within the Spanish Mass, it's as diverse as well. It's Guatemala, Ecuador, Mexico, Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, Colombia. So it's amazing because you learn and experience all these cultures and all these people. The last couple that you saw, the one that I was marrying, I was just actually at their new apartment last night, blessing their apartment. And they were telling me all about the section they're from in Guatemala. And then this language they speak called Quiche, which I've never heard of, but it's actually one of the native indigenous Mayan languages that they've maintained. And it was just amazing. Like, it's fascinating to meet these people and encounter them, their lives, their personalities, their backgrounds, you know, when they came to this country, how they got here, their stories of suffering and joys and being reunited with family. It's so life-giving, and it's fulfilling, and it's just great. It's really amazing. I wanna transition into my experience with confessions in particular. I think the first time that I gave someone absolution and absolved them, you know, you put your hand out there, you say the words, you know, and then you say, go in peace, your sins are forgiven. And you're like, what? Like, really? Like, do I have that power to forgive sins? And it's like the incredulous reaction that I had, I realized it's like, it was the same thing of what the people watching Jesus forgive sins must have felt. You know, I think of the paralytic, right? Go in peace, your sins are forgiven. And people are watching that and they're like, what? What's he talking about? Who is this guy to forgive sins? Like, how does he, you know? And then to prove it, right, Jesus performs a miracle. You know, get up, pick up your mat and walk so that they might know that your sins are forgiven. And he does. And people still didn't want to believe it, but like, it's true. It's real. So, and that's kind of my experience for all the sacraments the first time. The first time I baptized a child, you know, okay, you have new life in Christ. And I'm like, oh my gosh, so the water hit her head, she moved. I don't know, you know. Is this really happening? Like, is this person really reborn in Christ? Is their original sin washed away? Are they given protection from the evil one? Because you do these things and they're so simple, right? The sacraments are so simple. Anybody can take a piece of bread, hold it in their hands, and say those words that we say to consecrate the Eucharist. Anybody can hold your hand over somebody's head and say those words of absolution. But what's the difference when a priest does it, you know, personally, and someone just acting does it? And the difference is faith. It all comes down to know that Christ didn't leave us as orphans. He established his church. He established a leadership. He established a level of authority, which all powers on heaven and earth respond to that authority. That authority that Christ established is the authority in which we placed our hands, and the authority which placed their hands over our heads to confirm in us that same power and authority to forgive sins. So it's not just about putting your hand over somebody and saying the words of absolution. It's being embraced by the authority of Christ and manifesting that in the life of somebody. Because when somebody confesses to a priest, they're not confessing to me as Joe. They're speaking to God directly. And they have faith that that's what's happening in their life. They have faith that I'm telling this to God because this is who I am. This is my, you know, sometimes the most shameful things that I'm carrying with me, the most embarrassing things that I'm carrying with me. And I'm opening myself up and making myself vulnerable because I have faith that you, Joe, have the authority from the church, from God, to forgive my sins in the name of Christ, in the name of Christ, the head. And when you see that, and I'm speaking about their vulnerability to do that and their faith to do that, because that affects my faith and my reality. If it was just about me putting my hand over them and saying the words, like I said, anybody can do that. But when someone approaches you, the authority, the stole is a sign of that, that Christ's authority. When someone approaches you who are wearing that stole and manifesting that presence of Christ, and you see their level of faith and trust, it can't not change you. Automatically, you're changed by that because you realize how unworthy you are. Who am I to listen to this person spilling out their soul, spilling out their heart, shedding tears in front? Who am I to deserve? I'm nobody. Nobody. It's the authority that the church confirmed in me that allows me that opportunity to be in that moment and accompany that person. And I mean, it's happened where I find myself in tears with them because my humanity speaks to what they're speaking to. And like I said, there's never, I'm not going to say anything of what we hear in confession, but sometimes for people, a lot of times it's their first time putting themselves in that place of vulnerability and expressing verbally to another human being what they're experiencing, and they don't know how to react to it. So I've seen people, you know, shaking and nervous and anxious, and sometimes people have even asked at the end, you know, oh, do you think of me differently now? It's like, I wish that they knew that fully the trust that we work for 6, 7, 8 years to build, to conform our lives to Christ so that we can see all of humanity as God sees us, right? Psalm 139, where, O Lord, can I hide from your presence? You know, if I go into the darkness, you are there, so on and so forth. You knit me together in my mother's womb. God already knows everything about us. You know, God knows the whole spectrum of who we are, what we're thinking, what we see, where we've been successful, where we've fallen, what we're good at and what our sins are. And as a priest, those 6, 7, 8 years of training and of formation are meant to give you that eagle eye vision of seeing the world from above and seeing all of humanity as God's broken children whose salvation is not won by their good works, but by the work of Christ on the cross, right? I don't trust a single human being that they can gain their own salvation. People think they can gain their own salvation, right? Which is why they come to the confessional nervous and wondering if the priest is thinking about them differently, this and that. Like, people think that they can gain their own salvation, but we can't. It's all about abandonment and trust in the work of Christ on the cross. And the more we conform ourselves to that, both as priests and as Christians, the more our work becomes simple and easy. So someone can approach the confessional with total freedom and humility, knowing, hey, I'm not able to save myself. And the priest can enter the confessional saying, hey, I'm not able to save this person. There's no words that I can say, to give them perfect healing and to make their life perfect. The only words that I can tell them are the words of Christ, whose cross is the victory over all things, even death itself. So both approaching the confessional, because I myself go to confession as a penitent, and hearing the confession, it's there's a vulnerability on both sides, and there has to be a humility and trust and abandonment on both sides to know that this is God's work, and it's not mine, and I'm just there as an instrument, as a symbol, as a sign of God's authority on earth to perform the actions that he wanted to leave us so that we can all experience that welcome and that love. You know, John chapter 20, you know, whose sins you forgive are forgiven. I'm sure the disciples had the first reaction, you know, when they heard each other's sins and trusted that it was God's work forgiving. It's like, wait a second, is this really happening? Do I really have this power? Well, yes, but it's not my power by my humanity, it's power by the grace of the confirmation of the church of ordaining me and giving me that authority to perform it in the name of Christ. So, that's the first thing, and that was kind of a long one, that I want to say about confession, is that it's a total just trust and abandonment and humility in the work of God in our life, not my own work. I tell people all the time, I'm not a psychologist. I'm not a doctor. I don't pretend to be, you know, either. I'm a priest. I'm a person who seeks to conform my life closer and closer to Christ. And when penitents come forward and reveal to you who they are interiorly, it's a constant reminder of that humility, because you real as you hear people, you constantly realize that I'm totally not worthy to be listening to this. I'm totally not worthy to be accompanying this person in this moment. It's only Christ in me at work, you know, like St. Paul, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And I think that power is, I think that that reality that St. Paul expressed is probably more clear in the confessional, maybe in the consecration of the Eucharist as well, than in any other reality, you know. I mean, in all the sacraments, that power is present. Just a side story about another one of the sacraments, but I mean, I have so many stories about sacramental moments where Christ living in me became manifest. But just one about the anointing of the sick, I was called to the ICU one time, and this was right before COVID. The whole family was there. It was like 15 people in the ICU. This person was dying. Their health was failing. And they had like an uncle who was, you know, like an evangelical preacher, and he was there with his Bible preaching and giving people consolation and hope. And I'm sure he was doing a great job. Like, I'm not gonna, you know, hark on our Protestant brothers and sisters, but I'm sure he was giving them consolation. But I'll never forget when I walked in, this man, he was probably more well-versed in the Bible than I was. He was probably, you know, he was older than me. He probably had more experiences than of Christ and of preaching than I did. But I'll never forget when I walked in that room, 17 people, I think it was like 15 or 17 people. This preacher, he looked at me, he closed his Bible, stepped to the side, and it was like, okay, the priest is here. It's time to say goodbye to our uncle or brother or father. I mean, I just couldn't believe it. He closed his Bible, stepped to the side. I put my stole on and started with the prayers for the anointing of the sick and the final commendation. And again, I just go back to hark on that point of this is Christ in me. I'm sure this guy was more well-versed in scripture than I was. I'm sure he probably prayed more than I do. But like, because I had that authority of Christ and of the church, everyone recognized it, even this evangelical preacher who closed his Bible and stepped to the side. And that was just like an eye-opening moment of, this is Christ working in me. This is Christ living in me. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the priesthood is just filled with those moments. I mean, all the time. Sometimes I sit at my desk and I'm like, I'm sitting at my desk right now. Like, this is just like a random pile that I grab of like things that like I have to address today, you know, and then I have like a healing mass later and then confessions. And I'm like, sometimes I sit back and I'm like, there's no way I could do this. I'm 32 years old. Father Gino said I'm the administrator here. It basically means I'm a pastor without tenure. It's like, you know, you don't have a 6-year term as an administrator, but you're managing everything, the finances, the employees. We probably have like 10 employees. We have 5 major city buildings. I mean, my rectory is huge. We have 11 rooms in here. Our church is massive. It's an 1886 structure. Our school building is built in the 1920s. I mean, the boilers, the electric, the asbestos, like there is constant stuff happening. And this is like non-sacramental stuff in my administration of the church. And I'm like, I have no idea how to do any of this. I don't know anything about HR or asbestos or boilers or roofs or gutters or repointing of buildings. I actually have to Google, what does he mean? He wants me to repoint the building. Like, and now I'm taking estimates that are in the hundreds of thousands of dollars and trying to like fundraise for these types of things, because like otherwise the building's gonna fall apart in 10 years. So it's like, I'm like, I have no idea how to do that. But then like, you look at it one day and you're like, oh, wait a second, I am doing it. Like, it's happening. We're moving forward with these projects. People are coming together. The employees actually listen to me. The contractors actually respond to my emails and bargain with me. And like, it's just happening. And it's just more and more of that realization, that same realization that we experience in confession and in all the sacraments of, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And I mean, being at St. Paul's in an inner city church, I think that's a good phrase to sum up my experience. It's actually on the back of my business card. Let me pull one out right here. I didn't even think about it, but I got these when I came here. And I was just like, you know, what fits? And I put that on the back of the business card. Because you know, I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live is in the flesh. I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. St. Paul to the Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. To me, that's the experience of priesthood. And it is filled with surprises and joy and friendships and community and hope. That's really fundamentally what our job is to give people hope. It's about 1:35. So it says here that Father Gino will say we are ready for Q&A at 1:35. So Father Gino, go ahead and say that we are ready for Q&A.
We are ready for Q&A. However, before we jump right into it, I just wanted to share maybe just 2 things that Father Joe, to add a little bit on top of what Father Joe mentioned regarding confessions and regarding the administration of a parish, just to kind of give any young man who's in discernment something to kind of chew on, you know, in prayer. One little line that's written in the documents, don't ask me to quote where because I already forgot, but there's one little line regarding confessions that always just kind of flew over my head until I started hearing confessions as a priest, was this whole concept of carrying the burden of other people's sins. And I didn't really know what that meant. But the more people were able to unload everything that some of them might have been carrying for 5, 10, 20, 30, 40 years, when they unload that, you know, they walk away just on cloud 9. But you kind of carry that. Like when you're sitting down in prayer after hearing like some big ones, you can kind of say to yourself exactly what Father Joe has mentioned. Wow, who am I that a man shared something he has never shared, even with his wife, even with his kids? He has never wanted to share it, but felt compelled to do it because of something happened in his life or whatever. Even the most intimate people in certain people's lives don't get to hear the stuff that is deep down, the stuff that they're the most ashamed about or whatever. And you kind of carry that. You carry the weight of that invitation into people's darkest corners. And if you're not a man of prayer, you're not going to deal with that well. So Jesus gives us the grace to kind of carry those burdens of other people's sins. That's number one to kind of chew on. The second thing with the administration of the parish that I just wanted to share about, I moved from an enormous busy parish that had over 4,400 households in it. And Christmas morning mass was just such a spectacle, and I loved it, and it was so amazing. My first Christmas outside, after being moved, I was asked to cover for a guy who had an urban parish, but multiple sites, multiple worship sites. So I was at a church building that was one of these satellite sites. And it was my first Christmas after being at this enormous suburban parish. And I was pumped up. It was Christmas morning, 9:30. I was like, yeah, let's bring it. Six people came to mass Christmas morning. And I was down in the dumps, and I said to myself, because I'm an idiot, and I was like, this sucks. Six people, it's supposed to be Christmas morning. Like, I don't get it. What happened? You know, I was thinking about whatever experience I wanted, right, out of it. Until two of those people came up to me after mass and said, Father, thank you so much for doing this for us. We got married in this church 50 years ago. We commute here from South Carolina every Christmas to have mass here. And we just really appreciate you doing this for us today. And that warmed my heart so much, because it says to me that the administration of a parish church is not just about, you know, keeping like the lights on and the water running and the electricity. It's providing a concrete and sacramental place for people to return to the wellspring of life that they received in such pivotal moments in their lives. And that's a tremendous privilege for us. Because we're meant to be the concrete manifestation, the parish church is meant to be the concrete manifestation of the entire Roman Catholic Church in a given neighborhood, and it really gave me a lot to chew on as a parish priest. So I just wanted to roll those two things in there to color that up a little bit for anybody for whom that might be helpful. We are ready for Q&A. So if anybody wants to jump in with stuff, Rhonda will manage how that'll happen.
Yes. So if you have a question, you can put it in the chat. I've been putting together some questions based on what you both said. And thank you so much for sharing, giving us an inside look into that, into your ministry. I love that, the last part of what you said, Father Gino, about this concrete manifestation of the Catholic Church in this neighborhood, and thinking of the fact that you've got this rural, urban, small, how many households, Father?
We don't really know. It's hard to say. I mean, you know, we have a big immigrant population, and it's city parish. It doesn't really go by households. It's like,
so how many do you have normally coming to mass on Sunday?
Now with COVID times, I would say like, I don't know, 450, 500 people.
Okay.
Before COVID, it was maybe like 750-ish.
Okay, that's a pretty good size Parish, for sure. Okay, great. So, I mean, just gives us an inside look there to what that looks like. So within your, within that ministry, how is it for you going from sacrament to sacrament, like the daily priestly ministry of you're hearing confessions and then you walk out and the next thing, I've got to go deal with this building or I'm going to marry the people and then I go to the funeral. And how, what is that like for you?
Yeah, that was one of, it was one of the struggles at first, especially on Saturdays. Saturdays are one thing after another. So I always had that, like baptisms, funeral, memorial mass, wedding, confession, and then the Saturday night vigil. It is exhausting. Like it's just tiring. But it's like a good tiring. It's you realize that you're exhausting yourself in it. But fundamentally, everybody's seeking the same thing in all those moments. And it's kind of what I said towards the end is everybody's seeking hope. So if you kind of keep that common denominator throughout all of it and said, yep, we're all seeking hope in Jesus Christ when we bring our children from baptism because we want that blessing upon them. Yep, we're seeking hope in eternal life when we come to this funeral so that we know that, you know, our grandfather's in a place of peace. Yep, I'm seeking hope in confession to know that despite my sins, God still loves me as his beloved son and daughter. So I think keeping that common denominator throughout all those experiences is sort of what gives you the wherewithal to be able to go through it. But it is exhausting. But it's just, I mean, I try not to complain when I'm exhausted because then I go to people's homes and they're like, oh yeah, we work 12-hour days. And then like, you know, have to take our kids to baseball practice. I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah, my life's not that bad.
Well, we're all exhausted. Like, you know, meaning that we're all, that's a common experience for us is life is busy and full. And we hope that it is. We hope that your life is busy and full as a priest, because if you're just hanging out in your rectory and there's nothing ever to do, then that's a problem, right? I mean, that's not what the life of a priest is supposed to be, or what we know it to be. So my other question to you would be, what is it like if you've got to all that you just said, and you can be exhausted and all of that, how do you fuel yourself? I think Father Gino touched on this. Is there like practical things you do to fuel yourself to be able to do this work?
Yeah, you need to have, one, prayer. Like you have to be constantly going back to the source. So for me personally, I have sort of my structure. So I have the breviary is like front and center. Like if I miss midday prayer or like evening prayer, like something's wrong in my life. You know, like I get stressed out. So like for me, the breviary is sort of my bedrock of structure and of prayer and of constantly going back to the source. So for me, I have breviary, sleep and exercise. Because like for me, like meditative prayer kind of comes naturally, you know, eating a healthy diet kind of comes naturally. But like sleep and exercise, like I really got to force myself to make time for a good night's sleep, to make time for exercise, and to make time for prayer, because those things aren't like second nature, so to speak. And like having that structure and returning to the source, both the spiritual source and the physical source of like exercise, sleep, food, is key to being, you know, aware of yourself and others and responding to needs.
Yeah. One of the participants asked about how you keep your personal relationship with God front and center throughout the day. And I'm guessing it's through the breviary with your liturgy of the hours, like meaning you've got set times you're supposed to be praying throughout the day.
Throughout the day, it's definitely the breviary. Throughout the week, it's my day off. I take Tuesday off and I disappear. Like I go to the mountains, I go skiing, I go to the beach and just sit there and watch the sunset. I go meet up with friends. I go cook a dinner. Like Tuesday, everyone knows I disappear. I'm out. And I guess it's sort of like Christ going off to the mountain to pray. And that's the day where I can actually like sit and read a book or like listen to an audiobook in the car on, you know, whatever I'm listening to, you know? Breviary as far as structure of prayer, and then the day off as a sort of like Sabbath day, as a day of rest and prayer and refreshment.
Awesome. So the what do you say, both of you, I'd like to hear what your answer is on this pretty briefly as we're wrapping up, your greatest joy of being a priest.
Oh, you want to go first?
One of the greatest joys about being a priest, because I struggled with, you know, not having a wife and not having children, because I loved the thought of marriage and family life, obviously my whole life. And I wondered how the sacrifice of the priesthood would manifest itself. Because again, in theory, when you're discerning the priesthood, you see it as such a deprivation that you're like, oh, how am I going to deal with not having a wife and kids and the whole thing? Because that's such a life-giving part of the human experience. And your focus is on the deprivation. But there is something that we experience as priests in terms of just the intimacy of the friendship with all marriages and all family life that not a lot of people, very few people experience. I mean, there are some people in my life that exclusively because of my priesthood have welcomed me into their homes and have shared things with me and have just expressed such a closeness and a love for me that is, you know, thank God, always healthy, always appropriate, always life-giving, that I said to myself, I get it now. I get it how Christ in his celibacy was so loved by people and was really brought in to the life of everybody, and the priesthood is such a profound, profound experience of that. And I'm talking very elderly people, very young kids, and everything in between, where they feel a closeness to you, and it has really, like Father Joe said in the very beginning, it really has nothing to do with you. it has everything to do with their desire to be close to Christ, and they feel that through a faithful ministry. And the kinds of stuff, the kinds of experience I've had with family, marriages and families, it warms my heart so much, and that brings me a real joy.
So I think for me, the greatest joy is the food. I get the best chilaquiles from the Mexican families. I get the best pancit from the Filipino family. No, I'm just kidding.
No, it's a perk.
Yeah, it's a nice perk.
It's a perk.
Yeah. Especially in a diverse area, you get the best of the best. Just to echo from what he said, there's too many. Like, it's a joyful life. Like, what is wrong with miserable priests? Like, don't be miserable. If you just do your ministry, like, you will be happy. There was a gospel passage a few weeks ago where Jesus spoke about service. And I gave the homily and I was like, look, there's studies done where like service is sets off like the same like pleasure receptors in the brain as food and sex and alcohol. And it's like when you live a life of service and give yourself over to it, like you are joyful. Yesterday I woke up at 6 a.m. I got back into my room at 11 o'clock at night. I could list off everything I did, but like when you serve, you are happy. And I woke up feeling great, even though there was a truck beeping outside my window because it's the city and that happens, but you're still happy because it's like you're constantly in service. So it just feels good.
Okay, I know we've got some questions coming in the chat, and I know some of them are going to be best for who's talking about different aspects of ministry. But I'm going to go ahead and launch our poll for this hour for Newark. And so guys, if you'll just fill this out, anybody on with us now, we're just trying to gauge if you felt like this has been helpful to understanding the diocesan priesthood and then about hearing confession. So you just make your selections. I would ask, I guess this one last thing is about confession from one of the participants. Father Joe, if you want to answer, how often do priests normally go to confession themselves?
As often as possible. Here in Newark, we're blessed because there's priests on like every corner. I mean, we still don't have enough priests, but like, you know, every priest has their own spirituality. I go as often as possible as I can, you know. I saw there was a question too about how often we should offer confessions. I wish I could offer more. I wish I could be like John Vianney and just sit there, but like, there's so much to do. And confessions come up all the time. They it's not just the hour that's offered at Mass. You get confessions after Mass, you get confessions before Mass. People say, hey, Father, can I, I've heard confessions as people are walking out of church, you know, like, so it's always available. Just ask, you know, so.
Well, it looks like this was a really, everybody thought that this was really helpful. 100% said it helped them to understand the Diocesan Priesthood better. So praise God to that. And most everybody thought the same about confessions. So thank you so much for both of you for joining us. If you wouldn't mind, Father Joe, if you'll give one really short piece of advice for discerners and then give us your priestly blessing.
Sure. Piece of advice is the same advice that Christ constantly gave his disciples. It's actually his most repeated commandment in all of the Gospels, is do not be afraid. That's it. Do not be afraid. I'm with you always. You know, with me, all things are possible. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he let his face shine upon you and show you his mercy. May he turn his gaze towards you and grant you his peace. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. And God bless both of you.
God bless, guys.